70 again. The flicks. The fashions. The fads. The TV.
1 out of 12.
The tunes. A funky year that gave us even more burning questions.
Jeremiah was a bullfrog.
What exactly is a three-dog night?
When you have the beer goggles on, but you still go for a foursome. Am I right?
Is Dean Martin going to get charged with flying drunk?
Procked Dean Martin flying upon the pilot.
Is Norman Greenbaum the original Jew for Jesus?
Though he himself was Jewish, he could still be friends with Jesus, even if Jesus knew that Norman Greenbaum was going to hell.
The answers to those questions, plus the gimpy magic of Willis Reed.
What's he limping around for? He looks sick. If he was a horse, he'd be glue.
And the hippies' hidden agenda.
If we dress colorfully enough, nobody will notice that we're dirty.
Because you still love the 70s, because you've still got a gremlin in your garage, admit it.
It's a gremlin!
This is I Love 1970, Volume 2.
Damn you all to hell!
All right. Oh, yeah. Can you dig it? Volume 2.
Y5O was a very exciting police action show set in Hawaii.
McGarrett was the detective in charge of keeping Hawaii clean.
There's crime in Hawaii? Why does everyone look like Elvis?
Interestingly enough, the wave looks exactly like Steve McGarrett's hair.
Could hang 10 on that hairdo.
Each episode was a nail biter revolving around a typical Honolulu crime. Stolen Lays, poisoned poi, assaults on Don Ho.
If there is surf and sand, there are also a lot of criminals.
Catch your car.
No, Dano.
Dano was Jack Lord's assistant, and he was this weird skin-colored, kind of like a Ken doll guy that had that chin all the time and the short, curly hair.
Well, at the end of the show, usually when they nabbed the guy, Steve McGarrett would turn to his buddy Dano and go, "Book him, Dano.
Book him, Dano.
Book him, Dano.
Book him, Dano.
Book him, Dano.
Dano, I will give you the back of my hand if you don't book them.
Book him, bitch."
That was the catchphrase of that year.
Every third case should have been called the case of the girl in the bikini with the big boobs. So, what time did you happen to get home? Book 'em, Dano. And by book 'em, I mean.
But they always solved the crimes. They always took care of everything. And in the end, Hawaii was safer because of them.
Groovy.
American Motors introduces the Gremlin.
Oh my God, the Gremlin.
I love the Gremlin.
What were people thinking in the 70s?
No ride.
The Gremlin was like a shoebox that had wheels.
It was a small little car, but I remember like 8 of us fitting in there.
What is that? The Gremlin.
People go, "Look at your door." You're like, "I know. Look at this thing."
You couldn't pick up a in a Gremlin.
People have always admired the economical little Gremlin for its unique styling.
Where's the rest of your car, Toots?
The AMC Gremlin looks like a car that they didn't finish building because the back of it just like sliced off with like a butter knife.
It didn't come standard with hubcaps. That was an option.
It's almost a Pinto, and then they went, "Ah, we ran out of metal."
Does your husband drive the other half?
I actually lost my virginity in a Gremlin.
For some reason, I guess in the 70s, diarrhea brown.
Vomit green.
Dirty blue.
Baby orange.
And puke yellow.
Were very in vogue, and the Gremlin offered all of these colors.
Here's the design, and hey, look, that's the old penis.
But the AMC Gremlin made the special Levi's Denim Edition.
Gremlin's all-new Levi's blue denim interior trim option. It's a number one ego builder.
Blue jeans are comfortable.
Let's make seats out of blue jeans.
Might as well cover the seats in jeans, get you a big furry-ass steering wheel, hang some dice off your mirror, and get a wink.
More fun inside, more fun to own.
Vintage Vinyl.
Dun, 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 dun.
Biggest song in 1970, Norman Greenbaum, Spirit in the Sky.
Going up to Spirit in the Sky.
I didn't think people named Norman Greenbaum were allowed to sing songs. They can fill your cavities for you. If you need your taxes done, no problem. Singing Spirit in the Sky? My hat's off to you, Mr. Jew.
Greenbaum's Jewish? No.
Dreidel in the Sky wasn't as catchy.
Going up in Spirit in the Sky. I want to be the background of that song. In the sky.
I believe it's about the Lord and the heavens above.
I'm gonna go to the place that's best. Burger King? No. No.
Wait for it.
Wait for it. Heaven. Oh, that's Christian music. They're slipping it in on us.
I got a friend in Jesus.
Norman Greenbaum was the first Jew for Jesus.
Greenbaum's a Jew for Jesus?
He's a Jew for awesome songs.
Norman Greenbaum understood that though he himself was Jewish, he could still be friends with Jesus, even if Jesus knew that Norman Greenbaum was going to hell. Norman Greenbaum, if you're listening, you still have time to be saved. Jesus is more than a friend, Norman. He's your savior.
I love 70.
And now, Bruce Lee, Evel Knievel in Stunt Fu.
Dadgummit. Jack Schmidt having a few problems.
Groovy.
1970, the New York Knicks made the NBA Finals. Right in the center of it all was their center, Willis Reed.
I remember those tight shorts. You must have been a real comfortable man to wear shorts that tight.
New York was super crazy at that time.
That whole magical year climaxed in his incredible performance against the Lakers.
The big deal was that he got hurt.
Ball's down, we got a whistle on the play, and Willis is hurt.
They thought his career was over. Okay, they thought his career was done.
Willis very slow to get up.
It's the final game of the season, no matter who wins, and the Knicks obviously needed Willis Reed to play in this game, but nobody thought it was at all possible.
The big question is, will Willis Reed play tonight? Here comes Willis, and the crowd is going wild.
The drums are playing, and everybody's like, yes, he's here, he's gonna save the day.
Willis tests the point. 1, 2, 3! It is good!
Was going to go out on the court and he could hardly run.
His right leg was completely straight when he ran, okay?
And then he scores the first two baskets.
What a jump. Yes. Willis has hit on his first two.
His teammates are inspired. They win the game.
The New York Knicks are the world champions.
But Willis Reed only scores 4 points. People forget that. Maybe they didn't need him making the grand entrance on the gimpy ankle.
If I was a crowd, I would be like, get that cripple-ass dude off the... What's he limping around for? He looks sick. If he was a horse, he'd be glue.
And then you look at the rest of the Knicks team, and you're like, it's pretty good.
Dave the Butcher.
Yes!
Walt Frazier.
Yes!
Bill Bradley.
Yes!
Get down, get down.
I'd have dunked it right on his cripple neck. How about that, Willis? I'll play Willis Reed right now in the game. He's 96. I'm gonna break his hip and then play him. See how he does.
But if Willis Reed hadn't hobbled out there and really given the team a boost, the Knicks probably wouldn't have done it.
And he proved that you could do whatever you put your mind to. Then he just lumbered off into the sunset.
I love 70.
Coming up, the general's so tough, he's beating up his own guys.
Shut up!
Plus, Captain Dean Martin requests permission to get sloshed.
Procked Dean Martin, flying the fly, I'm the pilot.
Next on I Love 1970, Volume 2. But first,
Charo Debe. Oh,
Gucci, 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 Gucci.
1970.
Charo, you're on. Okay, okay.
Porn or not porn?
Hi, I'm John Waters, and it's time to play Porn or Not Porn. Here are three movie titles from 1970. You guess which are pornos and which are regular movies.
It just feels good.
Sex and the Single Vampire. Yep, it's a porno starring John Holmes as Count Spatula. Blood, sex, and kitchen implements. My kind of movie. Next up, Two Mules for Sister Sarah. Nah, you didn't see this in a back room in Tijuana. This was actually a Clint Eastwood movie that featured zero bestiality. Oh, well. And finally, A Man Called Horse. Now, here's a perfect title for a John Holmes movie. Unfortunately, it wasn't porn. This cowboy and Indians flick didn't even show the horse's penis. I'm John Waters. Thanks for playing, but I gotta run. I just located a vintage copy of Saturday Night Beaver. Want to join me?
Adam 12 rocked. It was just the story about two beat cops in Los Angeles fighting crime.
One Adam 12, see the man, a stolen vehicle report.
One Adam 12, see the man. Let's go!
Couple of cops in a car. Mark Milner played the older, the veteran cop. Pete Malloy.
Never guess it, would you?
And then Kent McCord was Jim Reed. He was the rookie cop.
You just wanted to be arrested by these two cops. They were hot, too.
One Adam 12.
I'm not sure what Adam 12 means.
Adam means a two-person patrol unit. And one Adam 12. One would be like a district, and then...
And two being the patrol or the beat. One Adam 12. Oh, that's us.
Pursuit and roll up your window.
That show seemed like a lot of driving and a lot of talking.
Life in the fast lane.
They're running out of road.
I don't think they were wearing seatbelts. Adam, buckle up.
Pete, Jim, be careful.
They always got the guy.
You guys play rough, don't you?
You were doing the driving.
Those guys were the greatest cops ever.
It's been one long day.
Dynamite.
There's a much more pressing problem. Should it be Mini or the Midi?
Next to the Vietnam War, the most contentious issue of the 70s was skirt lengths.
Midi skirts, a disaster in the 70s.
It's not short, it's not long, it's ugly as sin.
It was this thing like a lampshade, very A-line, mid-calf, very frumpy.
Why would you want to, like, celebrate kinkles?
See, I don't understand the point of a midi skirt. It's like being half circumcised. Either you are or you aren't.
You probably noticed that I'm wearing quite a few of my clothes just under the knee. Well, some people seem to like it, but not everyone.
Women felt like, how dare the fashion world tell them how to wear their clothing?
This year, the war won't be over our eyes or our legs, but right where it belongs, above our knee.
So I think they just went, okay, you want to sell me a midi? I'm going to make it a mini. And they just cut it off.
What's this supposed to be? It's not a protest if you bought it.
They get scissors and hack it off and get the air circulating around their legs and other regions.
We don't want middies. We want minis.
Oh, yeah, fight for your rights. Come here, cutie.
Ain't no stopping us now.
This was a fantastic era for horny men.
Yeah, you take that bra. Let your tits flap.
Because everywhere you look, there was some crazy chick burning her bra, hacking her midi off. I mean, it was just insane.
Vintage vinyl.
Detroit, and when she came out with Band of Gold, everybody was like, all right.
Band of Gold is my signature song, because that was the biggest hit.
The feeling, the vibe, it's a beautiful song.
Now, that was the all-time rejection song ever.
The only thing that got slipped in was the finger in the Band of Gold.
It had an upbeat tempo, but it's like she was just sitting in her room on her wedding night, and he just left her.
I guess you had to keep it upbeat like a nut.
Nada, all right. Woo! He left me.
You'll walk right through that door and love me like you did before.
I think that he was gay. And he left her because he realized that she was a woman.
Oh, no, that's not it. She's got the problem.
She's frigid.
Fucking Frida. Frida was frigid?
She was like Farrah Fawcett. She could have been the black Charlie's Angel.
Frida, you look good, girl. I'm glad that man left you. Look how you look now. Go ahead and pawn that ring.
Free the pain. Free yourself of the pain. Sell the band of gold.
The ring, baby. The ring.
I love sediments.
Time for Burt Reynolds' mustache. It's time for Burt Reynolds' mustache. That was Burt Reynolds' mustache. That was Burt Reynolds' mustache.
Bitchin'. Patton. I mean, what do you say? Just one of the great, great performances.
We're going to hold on to him by the nose, and we're going to kick him in the ass.
George C. Scott in Patton was one of the best roles ever.
We're gonna kick the hell out of him all the time.
Unbelievable. I think he believed he was Patton.
And we're gonna go through him like crap through a goose.
And when you stick your hand into a bunch of goo
that a moment before was your best friend's face,
you'll know what to do.
George S. Patton was a real general and actually helped win World War II.
Take a shot at me right in the nose!
The plane was shooting machine gun fire at him. He pulled out a pistol and shot back at the plane. I said, oh, this guy is crazy.
George C. Scott was a sick mother, as Pat. Sick.
He was like the first guy I was ever officially scared of.
You damn coward!
That movie was just terrifying.
You don't mess with George C. Scott. You don't. Although sexually you do, because he'd be a badass in the bedroom.
So George C. Scott eventually won the Oscar for Patton.
I am going to be allowed to fulfill my destiny.
My favorite thing about Patton was when George C. Scott decided to decline his Oscar. I think that's like the ultimate cool.
Americans love a winner.
George C. Scott didn't want to go to the Academy Awards because he thought it was a meat parade.
Hey, George C. Scott. What do you got there, huh? Give us a little twirl there, George C.
It's a meat parade. I'm not going to that frickin' Oscars. We're gonna go through the Oscars like crap through a goose.
God, how I hate the 20th century.
Coming up.
The inspiration for Three Dog Night's Ode to Joy.
We are so baked. Joy to the fishes, joy to you, man, joy to me.
Plus, this is Rock and Roll Radio.
Casey's creepy long-distance dedications.
Dear Casey, my mom, she's been molesting me since I was 12.
Next on I Love 1970, Volume 2. But first, songs to make whoopee to.
Hi there, I'm Bob Eubanks. You know, everyone loves to make whoopee. That's why I've compiled this great new album, Eubanks, Songs to Make Whoopee To. This double LP has all the classics, such as The Horizontal Disco, Sweaty Amps, The Backseat of My Pinto. Didn't I Blow Your Mind This Time? Waterbed Boogie, Make It With You.
I'd like to make it with you.
This special double LP set is available for a limited time only. Also available on 8-track and cassette. Don't wait. Order now. I'm Bob Eubanks. Keep on whooping.
Hi, I'm Allison Arngrim. 30 years ago, I played Nellie Olson, that little blonde bully on Little House on the Prairie. That's right. 3 decades ago. Luckily, time's been good to me.
Makeup.
Let's take a look at what the last 30 years have done to these people. Mike Nesmith, then and now. Michael Jackson, then and now. Mike Lookinland, then and now. Hope you didn't judge too harshly. Remember, half pints. Someday you'll be 3 decades older.
Airport was the first in a line of disaster films in the 70s.
Yeah, we had the Poseidon Adventure.
Earthquake.
Towering Inferno.
They're like the equivalent of Hollywood Squares for aged, you know, TV actors. It's where film actors go to die.
The Airport was classic disaster film.
Grab him, he's got a bomb!
Mad bomber on board.
And they needed a place to land, but the airport was completely snowed in.
It's like any sort of 1970s disaster movie. The airport has about 35 subplots going on at once.
We've got the crazy old lady smuggling jewels.
Helen Hayes, one of the great actors of the American stage, who's, you know, forced to play a stowaway.
Have you ever been a stowaway on any other airline?
Oh, yes. But I like Transglobal the best.
It just proves my theory that old ladies just aren't good. They're not good. I mean, old ladies are nothing but trouble.
But you know, my favorite part about Airport is that Dean Martin is the captain. The drunk is the captain.
I want something under my wheels that's plenty long and mighty dry.
Rocked Dean Martin, flying the plane, the pilot.
You get me up to full throttle, then throw me into reverse. You could damage my engine that way.
Jacqueline Bisset and Dean Martin were getting it on. Let's be honest, that was a hot couple. Hot. So George Kennedy shows up because he's the only one who can fix whatever is going on.
Hold the whipped cream, I've just had dessert. All right, I'll be there.
George Kennedy, yeah, he can handle a crisis.
Favorite part of the movie is watching Helen Hayes, the old lady, getting beaten up.
You're hysterical.
I know we're all gonna be.
That's a great movie. Of those disaster movies, obviously, that's the granddaddy.
Nice going, sweetheart.
I love 70.
Look who's got a Faraday.
Don't you wish you had one too?
Smoking.
The 70s were defined by three words. Three dog night.
Child is black, a child is white.
I can't picture in my head what three dog night looked like.
The reason why three dog night were so popular in the 70s is because women cannot resist a mustache.
I know I like their name an awful lot, and I like that song, Joy to the World.
Jeremiah was a bullfrog.
We are so baked. Joy to the Fishes, Joy to You Man, Joy to Me. Kind of encapsulated the entire decade in those lyrics right there. Except for My Hatred.
I have no clue what Three Dog Night's supposed to mean.
To me, a Three Dog Night is when you have the beer goggles on, but you still go for a foursome. Am I right? Am I right?
Legend has it that Chuck Negron had so much sex with women that at one point his schwadango exploded.
Boom! I gotta get away!
Oh, you know, all those details would have been missed if Chuck Negron didn't write his own autobiography, Three Dog Nightmare.
He must have been doing a lot of octane for you to get like that. I'm sorry.
I explained rather feebly, trying to recover my cool. It split. In short, my penis had virtually exploded.
I have a theory about Chuck and his exploding penis. They did a song a long time ago, Mama Told Me Not to Come.
Mama told him not to come, and if you have that much sex, your penis will explode.
Someone get a fire extinguisher, my penis is exploding.
Certain fluids build up. Something's gotta give.
Mama told me not to come, and my blew up.
Mama told him not to come.
You should have listened. I'm an ass.
I love 70.
This magnetic diskette is the complete medium for data entry.
Do I remember what the first floppy disk looked like? Hello?
Is that the first damn floppy disk?
That's a very large floppy.
Oh my God, the floppy disk.
It's an album!
I feel like I could accidentally put this on a turntable and it would start playing Pink Floyd music. All in all, it's just a
brick in the wall.
Nothing associated with computers should be floppy.
Might need some Viagra.
Floppy is for rabbit ears.
Yeah, this was cutting edge. Are you kidding?
Floppy is for Easter bonnets.
It's going to be such a big thing in the future for education and all kinds of purposes. It's a floppy disk. It has a lot of information, over 100,000 pieces of information on it.
And then it's got bytes.
256 bytes? I think I got to, I think my phone holds more than that.
This small hole in the lower left corner of the floppy disk is most important. It must be covered in order to write on the disk.
It was a stack this big for a resume. Patrice.
Okay.
Save. Oh, man, that's hilarious. Don't bring me down.
Bitchin'.
The guitar god.
Mind blowing.
It was just amazing.
God bless him.
Yeah.
There's not a guitarist that can even mess with it, can't even compete with Jimi Hendrix. Black man. Just want to let y'all know that.
When I'm on stage, I'm complete natural, more so than, you know, talking to a group of people.
I was in a band, and all the guitarists, that's what they tried to do, is play as well as Jimi Hendrix.
As weird and out there as he was, a purist, he just loved that guitar, and Jimmy just loved his guitar.
We call our music electric church music.
Electric church?
Yeah, because it's like a religion to us.
At Monterey Pop, when Jimi Hendrix lit his guitar on fire, he had sex with that guitar. I guess I'm into some kooky things, but sex and fire? This could be awesome.
Excuse me while I kiss the sky. Excuse me while I kiss the sky. That's a bad dude right there. Excuse me, I gotta kiss the sky real cold now.
When Jimmy died, it was a big shock to me.
Jimi Hendrix died, unfortunately, at the age of 27 in 1970.
Sometimes people that are so incredibly talented, they're like a supernova, man.
Baddest dude that ever lived. 27 years old!
They flare really out and burn out, and they're gone.
I love 70. Coming up, the story behind Sly Stone and his far-out family.
Basically, these are like 9 people who got baked together and went, we should form a band.
And what the hell's Sean and I doing at Woodstock?
You are everything we are rebelling against. Get off the stage.
Next on I Love 1970, Volume 2. But first, the guitar gods of 1970.
Hi, Peter Frampton here, bringing you the guitar gods that made 1970, yes, come alive. Chicago's Terry Kath, Dwayne Allman from the Allman Brothers Band, and the all-powerful, supreme being, it's Jimi Hendrix. And those were the guitar gods of 1970.
Hi, I'm Gloria Gaynor, and when I first sang I Will Survive, you better believe I meant it. I survived disco dancing, gaucho pants, and even fondue burns. But I wasn't the only one. Here are the survivors of 1970. Allie McGraw survived never having to say I'm sorry. Jane Fonda survived being Hanoi Jane. And Alice survived cooking and cleaning for the Bunch, the Dog, and the Butcher. I will survive. Those were the survivors of 1970. Now go, walk out the door.
I love the 70s.
Volume 2.
Good morning. What we have in mind is breakfast in bed for 400,000.
Ah, yes, Woodstock the movie.
This is really a mind f***er of all time.
Hey, get some cameras. Maybe we should film this thing.
When I saw it, I was probably 12,
just getting into drugs and sex, not having them, but really thinking about them a lot.
It was all just fun, free love, free music.
The hippies, come on, there was no peace, love, blah, 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 blah. It was, let me get my rocks off and get baked.
The brown acid is not specifically too good.
The great thing about Woodstock, the movie, when I saw it was an excuse to watch dirty, filthy hippies roll around in mud.
You think they're throwing mud in Woodstock. It's not mud. I got nowhere to put this. Throw it to Duane Allman.
I see all these long-haired people having sex, listening to music. Boobies!
I'm tripping on acid, I'm dancing and pissing, my wife's got her boobies hanging out. It's rules!
The best thing about the Woodstock movie for me was it was my first real introduction of some of these bands. Especially The Who, which was like really my first favorite band.
When Roger Daltrey in his fringe like lifted up. It was like, oh my gosh, you saw that on the screen and man, I want to be a rock star.
I was like, sha-na-na. No, like, huh?
They were from a decade that was previous, which was all
You are everything we are rebelling against. Get off the stage.
Sha-na-na-na-na-na-na-na.
The favorite performance for me was definitely Hendrix.
Where he's playing the Star Spangled Banner. Amazing, man.
Look at the kids back in the 70s. He had 500,000 kids on Yasgur's farm. No fights, no fires set. It was a marvelous event, and it's never been duplicated.
Isn't that far out?
Groovy. I'm Casey Kasem, and the countdown continues. KT's Top 40 comes to you from Hollywood.
This is Rock and Roll Radio.
America Top 40, that was a place for people who liked, you know, bubblegum pop.
Welcome to American Top 40.
Casey Kasem ruled my world.
Is he a real person?
Are we on the air?
Yeah, we're on the air.
Is this for real?
Are we on? That is for real.
He got on the air every week and told you what the most important songs you had to know to fit in at school was.
And there you have him, the 40 biggest hits on the pop chart.
His voice was like a drug. But the long-distance dedications were exceptional.
The long-distance dedication was how I learned about how much difficulty there was in the world.
Dear Casey, my mom, she's been molesting me since I was 12.
So if you would, Casey, can you please send out Rock the Boat?
Rock the boat, don't rock the boat, baby.
I'm sorry I killed your sister, and you and I should get together sometime. Is that right?
Casey Kasem always had this catchphrase.
Keep your feet in the ground and keep reaching for the stars.
I've gone through my life repeating that mantra in my head, and it has helped me through some of my darkest days. Last night a DJ
saved my life. Recently, Casey Kasem was replaced by Ryan Seacrest from American Idol.
Okay, deep breath. Ryan Seacrest.
Look. Nobody loves Ryan Seacrest more than me. I mean, that's documented. But can you replace Casey Kasem? Can a Hyundai replace a Ferrari? Not where I live, chump.
I love 70.
Now let's see what Dom cooked for Hawkeye and Trapper John.
Garlic mashed potatoes. Yummier than a night with hot lips.
Foxy.
Get up and dance to the music.
Sly and the Family Stones is the truth.
That's the essence of soul right there.
These are just a number of energetic young people singing and dancing their troubles away.
Like, the Family Stone was probably Catholic. Because there had to be, like, 30 of these people.
There'd be like 7 guitar players and 2 bass players and drummers and like 7 vocalists.
Basically, these are like 9 people who got baked together and went,
we should form a band. They were just everyday people. Just they grabbed them off the street and suddenly they were Family Stone.
They were a multiracial group at a time where that didn't exist at all.
They had something to teach the world, the country.
To me, it's just about the music, not about the black people, the white people, you know, unless there's an Asian, because I have a thing for those chicks. We got to live
together. They were
funky, the music was funky, the clothing was funky.
They all had huge afros.
Even the white people had afros.
So they were like a team.
I wanna thank you for letting me be myself again.
I love Thank You for Letting Me Be Myself, the way they write it, thank you.
When you read it, it's like, thank you for being mice, elf. Again.
No. I don't know what made him think of that, but that was crazy.
A lot of their songs had silly pop-sounding titles that had darker messages, like Don't Call Me Whitey.
Don't call me Whitey.
It might as well be something Britney Spears is singing.
That song broke a lot of ground for future songs, like DMX's What You Bitches Want From It. So thank you, Sly.
I love 70.
In the 70s, fashion just went sleazy and nasty, and I don't know why, but it did.
Hippie fashion, the idea was, if we dress colorfully enough, nobody will notice that we're dirty.
Why do the hippies do anything? Because they're stoned.
They had a lot of munchies. You want to be able to hide those extra pounds someplace. It's good to have flowing fabrics. They are slimming.
Hippies didn't really have their own style. They were just taking it from everybody else.
As if the Native Americans hadn't had it bad enough with the Trail of Tears, they now had hippies dressing up like them.
It was just something about a bunch of skinny-looking Grizzly Adams walking around in vests with dangly things. Hey, I'm hippie, man. How do you know? I look like a fishing lure.
It's 1970, and hippie fashion and kind of like fatigues are cool at the same time, which doesn't really make sense to me.
Hey, there's a war on. We hate the soldiers. Let's dress like them. In 1970, they discovered irony. It was their way of saying, hey, man, we're with you, but we're not.
It would have been nice if it had come full circle and our infantrymen started wearing tie-dye, but that's not very good camouflage for Vietnam.
Coming up, Chuck Heston takes some extreme measures.
Even Charlton Heston would admit that blowing up the planet is pushing the limits of the Second Amendment.
Next on I Love 1970, Volume 2. But first, that's no jive, Turkey, with Rachel Harris.
Wow, they're putting Levi's denim in the interior of the Gremlin. What's great about the denim is that it absorbs anything you can give it, because you're going to be doing a lot of f***ing in the backseat of your Gremlin.
But wait, there's more.
Craving some Volume 2 bonus material and 70s ringtones? Then log on to VH1.com and make sure to check out V-Spot.
Hey, I'm not a Brady.
Hi, I'm Christopher Knight. Some of you know me as Peter Brady, but indeed I'm Christopher Knight. You see, I'm real. Peter is fake. I'm 40-something. Peter is a preteen. Don't believe me? Peter Brady's first jobs were as an ice cream clerk, pizza delivery boy, and at the bike shop. Mine were commercials for Toyota Tide and Cheerios. Peter Brady didn't want to portray Benedict Arnold in the school play. I don't want to portray Peter Brady in life anymore. Hope that clears things up.
That's the way we became the Brady Bunch.
Have a very Brady day.
I love the 70s.
Volume 2.
My God, it's a city of apes.
Beneath the Planet of the Apes is the second installment of the Great Planet of the Apes series.
Planet of the Apes 2, Electric Boogaloo.
What was the fascination with apes?
Your lips don't move, but I know what you're thinking.
This is the one where Chuck Heston goes underneath, discovers the X-Men. They're mutants. They're human. They're humans.
All the kind of mutant humans who lived underground look like Darth Vader without his helmet.
we meet some subterranean telepathic humans who are worshiping an atom bomb.
The heavens declare the glory of the bomb.
They found him.
That's where the WMDs were on the Planet of the Apes.
They were beneath.
There you go.
Well, maybe not physically, but here. Here, you can hurt here, I know.
We humans didn't come off too well beneath the Planet of the Apes, did we?
The only good human is a dead human.
And apes. Who made those movies? Apes?
They're all fighting with the apes. The apes are all shooting talons, shooting them.
Tell you, you never want to get involved in a land war with apes.
And I love Charlton Heston's scene.
You'll get this bomb when you pry it out of my cold, dead hands, you damn dirty ape.
Charlton Heston embodied the all-American guy who was in charge, and when he wasn't in charge, he's going to make it right.
That's the idea. Taylor. Nova.
No one will forget Nova. She was beautiful. Some kind
of wonderful. Nova was honestly a babe, and she was halfway naked all the time.
And was mute. She had one of those meticulously, perfectly torn bikinis. You know what I mean? That's supposed to convey kind of savage, but it more conveyed like Sports Illustrated.
She says her first word in this movie.
Taylor.
She says Taylor. Did you know that?
Taylor.
I love this so much, I should imitate. I would always imitate like Cornelius and, you know, and do the whole...
Enough of this nonsense.
As Moses, Charlton Heston showed his power by changing his staff into a snake.
Bloody bastard.
In Beneath the Planet of the Apes, he ratchets it up a bit and shows his power by blowing up the world. Even Charlton Heston would admit that blowing up the planet is pushing the limits of the Second Amendment.
Damn you all to hell!
Boss. Guess this Joe, it's a Joe you know. If you don't know this Joe, then it's a Joe you don't know. But if you can guess this Joe, it's a Joe you know. So guess this Joe, hey, guess this Joe.
Joe Torre!
I love 70.